I have to say that over the course of yesterday and today, a few of, and I will not name names, a few of the panelists here came up to me and said, so what is Arthur going to ask us about? And I was able to say with complete candor, I haven't the foggiest idea. So we'll see. There is a one thing I wanted to say, which is that after a few minutes, this is going to be a bit of a participatory theater, meaning that you guys are also part of the roundtable, and you're able to shout out or ask questions as the mood strikes you. I say participatory theater. Maybe it's more like the Globe Theater in Shakespeare's time. You guys are the groundlings, and you're allowed to participate. So, Arthur?
Thank you, Peter. I'm not going to give a long introduction. We have five judges. Three of them you've met in earlier phases of the seminar, Judge Barbier, John Koeltl, Shira Scheindlin. But the statistics in the last session were so striking about the density of class actions in the Southern District of New York that we put in a call and we got two more Southern District judges, Lou Kaplan and Jeb Rakoff. So they've been told nothing. No papers, nothing. And that goes for me too. We're going to have a bull session. It is a bull session. I have said to them, you talk whenever you want to talk. And we'll see what happens. And Peter has just invited you in. Just wait a few minutes until you get a sense of them. You've all had big cases. MDLs, class actions. I'll start with you, Judge Scheindlin, since you're off the bench now. Hmm? You told us yesterday about your B2 cases. When a biggie came in, this is just touchy-feely, when a biggie came in, what went through your mind?
A biggie being any biggie. B2, B3, yeah. Class action, MDL, or anything else.
Yeah,
I said, good, I got a good draw from the wheel today. So I was very happy to get a so-called biggie, because I knew the lawyers would be great, I knew the issues would be challenging, it made my day. After all, the caseload has a lot of kinds of cases in it, and I don't know how to put it politely, but not all of them are equally challenging or equally well represented. So it's a good day when you get a big, challenging
case.
It
sounds very masochistic to me.
No. Well, some of us are workaholics, five of us, I think, on this panel. So the harder the case, the more we like it.
Bigness is goodness.
Well, it's not just that it's big. It's that we know it's going to be well-lawyered, and the issues are going to challenge us. And we're going to have an exciting time for the next, you know, year, 2 years, or three, or God forbid, 10. And we know it.
That's a hell of a negative commentary on all the other lawyers.
Well, I didn't mean to be negative on other lawyers. In fact, some of the cases have no lawyers. As you know, 25% of our docket is pro se in the Southern District of New York, for those of you who didn't know that. Now, those cases can develop into fascinating cases, too. But we have to do that work. There's no great lawyer doing it. So anyway, you asked me about biggie. I answered you about biggie.
Judge Rakoff?
So I mix, well, I should say in advance that it's always difficult for me to agree to be part of a panel moderated by Arthur Miller because it reminds me of the pain of law school. Anyway, to answer your question.
I'm not going to touch that.
I have very mixed feelings about big cases because what I live for is trials, and big cases almost never go to trial. They do have, as Shira pointed out, great lawyers. They have interesting issues. Administratively, they're always a great challenge. But at the end of the day, they're going to settle. And to me, that's not as much fun as a trial.
Judge Koeltl?
I have very mixed feelings when you get a very big case. First of all, I come from a tradition. I clerked for Judge Weinfeld on the Southern District of New York. Judge Weinfeld's mantra was, every case is important, every case is interesting. And I have really internalized that. So the small cases that come in are interesting. They may be more challenging because of the people involved or the quality of the lawyering. But you can appreciate that, you know, your role as a judge is to be just, and when you get individual cases like that, you feel it. With respect to the big cases, I don't necessarily relish the thought of being deluged with briefs, papers, motions. That's not the biggest part of what I enjoy. Yes, the papers are very good, but there are many more of them. anyone who thinks that a judge you know, is about to go to sleep and says, I think I'll delve into one of those five boxes on that motion for summary judgment, doesn't truly get the mindset of judges. So one of the problems with big cases is huge amounts of paper, that it's some of it quite unnecessary, which I don't necessarily enjoy. The lawyers are good, generally. The quality of the arguments are good. The intellectual challenge is good, so that those parts of it are fun. There are other parts of it that are not so much fun.
Judge Kaplan?
I don't really have anything to disagree with that's been said so far, really. I'd add a couple of footnotes. I mean, occasionally big cases do go to trial. Big criminal cases usually go to trial. And so if it's a big criminal case, that is really a happy day. Even big civil cases on occasion go to trial. I tried a case in the Parmalat multi-district litigation, a multi-billion dollar case, and it was a great trial. And so that was a delight, but John's absolutely right. The deluge of paper is an administrative and intellectual nightmare sometimes. And I promised the plaintiff's class action bar in the securities world that I have tolerated my last complaint in excess of 100 pages. You're on notice.
Does it bother you that it's going to be around, or may be around, for one hell of a long time? I mean, when you look at your own retirement point, and you think this case will be here after me? There's a slight smile on your face. That doesn't bother you, Lou?
Well, what bothers me is how long the Court of Appeals takes when a case gets certified. Forever. And all of us here, I think a common element of the judges here is that we run a tight ship and we keep closely to the schedule that's been set. And then it goes up to the Court of Appeals and the case is, you know, only halfway done. And, you know, 5 years later, you may see it. So,
Your question does prompt a recollection, which is that on the day I reported for duty in 1994, there was on my desk a note from my good friend from practice, then Judge John Martin. Dear Lou, congratulations. There are 400 cases on your docket this morning. There will be 400 cases on your docket the day you die. Pace yourself.
And Judge, what about you? You've had your share of biggies.
Well, I have, of course, nothing compares to the Deepwater Horizon case, but I had in previous years a number of big, we have a lot of admiralty cases mm-hmm. down in New Orleans, and we get these big admiralty limitations. I had the case of the Brightfield, which is a foreign ship that hit the Riverwalk shopping center along the river, and thousands and thousands of claims, sort of like a class action on MDL, thousands of individual claims, property, everything from property damage to personal injuries. But when I was assigned, I asked to take the Deepwater Horizon case in 2010, I thought about it, and I knew it would be challenging. So the first thing I did was walk up two floors to my good friend Eldon Fallon, mm-hmm. who's the guru of MDLs, at least in our world, my world. And Judge Fallon and I are on the treadmills next to each other every morning at about 6 o'clock. And so he's a great resource. So I told him about, you know, what the case was about, gave him a general description, and I said, do you think I should do it? He said, yeah, you should do it. It's gonna be very interesting. I said, well, how do you suggest I go about tackling this monster, you know, this organizing it? He says, it's like eating an elephant. You have to take it a bite at a time, you know? And so that's how we started. But I'll tell you, I've loved it. It's been fascinating, as it's been stated by other panelists. You get the great thing about this kind of case, these kinds of cases, is you get some of the best lawyers in the country. And I've had nothing but praise for the lawyering in the case. The legal issues have been fascinating. We've had to resolve a large number of new legal issues in different areas of law. I mean, we had about 15 or 20, I have a list somewhere, about 20 different laws that were potentially applicable. So a lot of choice of law issues between state law and federal law, and between various federal laws, and as to what, you know, what the proper legal choices should be. So anyway, it's been fascinating, and I enjoy that. And the great thing about this case too is, unlike most of these cases, even though we had a number of big settlements, we also had three big trials. I had one trial, first trial went 3 months, second trial went about 2 months, and the third went almost another month. And so I've gotten the best of both worlds, I think.
Arthur, I wanted to add one thing to push back a little bit on something that Jed said. He said he lives for the trial and these may not go to trial. Well, one thing that I really like about the big cases is that actually more people will read the decision, the opinion, which I really love doing, than in a one party each side case, where the only two people in the world who will ever read the opinion are the plaintiff and the defendant and their lawyers. In a big case, the opinion might really be read by thousands of people, at least over time. And that's an exciting point to me because I love writing opinions.
Well, that, of course, I couldn't disagree with at all. What I like about trials is it's the one place in our system where the truth comes out, where you know who's right and who's wrong, when you know where the facts are, when you know when the system really has been put to the test, and all the rest is interesting, sometimes important, legal discussions, allegations put to various legal standards, but I'd like to know what really happened. And a trial is when you really find out what happened.
I could push back to that too a little bit. Trial is theater. I'm not so sure the truth always comes out, in fact. It comes out to the extent that the evidence permits it to, and it may not be all that could come out. So I've often wondered whether the trial is all that is cracked up to be. Well, but it's the best we have. You know?
It's a lot. Right. It's a lot right. Closer to the truth right. than what occurs during motion practice.
Right. That's for sure.
And let me second that. One reason why district court judges enjoy being district court judges is because of the diversity of the experience, the ability to actually see real people at trial testifying, to see jurors. to deal with the problems that come up day in and day out in a trial is really fascinating. I remember visiting in Paris one time, and I was talking to a French judge who was both a first instance and also an appeals court judge, and one of the areas of her practice was domestic relations, and she pointed to the record in a case and she said, explained how she would decide the case based upon the witness statements and all. And I said, well, sometimes don't the parties put in declarations that conflict with each other? And she said, yes, but then we just analyze the declarations and determine who's telling the truth. And I was plainly aghast, and she looked at me and said, what, put them on the stand and see if they sweat? I said, yeah, that's a good idea.
Does it make any difference to you if it's a class action or an MDL?
Or both.
Or both, as it often is?
Not really.
You have the same fun with either one of them?
The MDLs turn into long-running administrative problems because there are the follow-along cases, and there are follow-along cases for all kinds of reasons. Some lawyer in Missoula, Montana, has an individual client, files it, it gets caught in the MDL, and there he is. Or some lawyer in Texas decides that for some tactical reason having to do with relations among the plaintiff's counsel, he's going to file on behalf of 600 people in El Paso, and that will get swept into the MDL, and all of a sudden you have a different kind of issue on your hands. But other than the administrative side of it, no, not really.
You don't feel liberated with an MDL since there's basically no rule? You can be as lawless as you want?
I reject the premise categorically. I read last night the draft of a paper that Abby Gluck at Yale wrote about MDLs and the lawless state of the world. And I have enormous admiration for her, and she made wonderful points in some respects, but I think the fundamental premise is just not right. I mean, the area where we have a lot of scope to innovate or do things differently in MDLs is pre-trial procedure, where I have substantially the same scope of discretion, although less occasion to use it, in other kinds of litigation, whether it's class actions or individual cases.
Arthur, what I really liked about MDLs is because they run so long sometimes, you really do develop expertise, which you can't do in the run-of-the-mill cases. But when you have a case for 5 years or 10 years or 4 years, you've drilled down. For once, you're equal to the lawyers. You actually know a lot about that subject matter, maybe more than some of the lawyers, and you can use that knowledge. And I wish that was true in every case, but it can't be, not with several hundred cases.
Not the same with the class action? We were asked so many different questions just by the rule.
But you don't have them for the length of time. Because of that follow-on that Lou referred to, some MDLs just don't end. I mean, they're gonna outlive you. They keep coming and coming. So I had one for 15 years. By that time, I really knew a lot about the subject matter as well as a lot about the lawyers, but put that aside. But you can really drill down in a way that you can't in the typical case, which comes and goes.
Several of you have mentioned the quality of the lawyers. What are those qualities? They're just smarter?
They're
certainly can write more pages.
No, better pages, too.
They're smart and they're prepared.
Yeah.
Mostly.
They have, the truly great lawyers have a way of expressing arguments in what they write and what they say that is succinct and intelligent. The quality, the number of pages doesn't necessarily express the quality of the lawyers. The truly great lawyers are able to do it with clarity in fewer pages, actually. And you can read an argument and say, you know, that's correct. That's, you know, That's correct. Judge Weinfeld once characterized two great law firms before him, and he said, these papers are so good, I read one set of papers, I say, you're right. I read the next set, and I said, no, you're right. I read the reply, and say, no, you're right. That is not necessarily the rule in all cases that come before you.
So I'm hearing so far.
I'm going to add one thing, though, just which is the lawyers in class actions tend to be highly credible. And by that, I mean when they make a representation, because not everything can always be put in paper. Something comes up at oral argument. You can rely that they're telling you that they won't distort a case out of all sense. They won't claim that there's some fact out there that they really don't know is out there. Very high credibility. There are exceptions, but they are rare. That's not necessarily true of the bar as a whole.
And I will say that they will deign to come to the district court to argue a motion, so I had the pleasure of hearing Sam Zakharoff against Sheila Birnbaum. They're usually doing that at a circuit court or even the Supreme Court, but they deigned to come into district court because the issue was important enough that each side sort of felt it was a must win. So to have an oral argument with advocates of that level is a pleasure.
And they listen to you?
To me? I listen to them hard.
No, both. Both. I mean, you make a ruling. They say, yes, judge. You can talk to them. You don't even need it oftentimes on the record because you can trust them that when you say something, they will follow it. And they're not going to come back with lots of letters caviling over what you said.
And after having spent the evening before with my wife and children, it's nice to have someone who will listen to me.
I take it, although Judge Rakoff referred to class action lawyers, this characteristic of credibility, reliability goes across the MDL.
Yes, lawyer. Yes.
I was going to say, with respect to the MDLs, that the requirements or obligations for counsel, I think, are a little different too, because even in class actions, because of their, what I would describe as their ethical or fiduciary responsibilities, which goes not only beyond their own clients and if there's a class, but across the entire MDL, all the lawyers who have been more or less disenfranchised when the committees are appointed. So I think the lead lawyers and plaintiff steering committees, for example, have an obligation to these other lawyers, and that can cause some ethical issues where, you know, they may have to consider whether to subordinate their own interests, clients' interests, to the interests, to the greater good of the class, not the class, but the case as a whole. And that raises some interesting ethical issues. I think it's important for that reason that you have lawyers, I call it playing, that can play well with others in a sandbox. I know some great lawyers that I would never put on a committee in an MDL because they can't get along with others. And they may be great lawyers, great trial lawyers.
Yet the revised Rule 23 does put an obligation on the district judge to select counsel. So yeah. I would assume the same issues would arise there. You've got to trust those people.
Right, exactly. But I think their ability to deal with others is even more important in an MDL context than a class action. Just a straight class versus an MDL.
Judge Kaplan.
Obviously, you have class actions within the MDL.
Yeah. You seem to be agreeing.
Well, I'm definitely agreeing. It is more important than an MDL because there's so much greater centrifugal force in an MDL on the plaintiff side. There just isn't any in a class action usually.
And you hear a lot, sort of related to this point, that there's a lack of transparency in an MDL in terms of these distant lawyers who, as you pointed out, Judge Kaplan, have been co-opted into your court, may exist 3,000 miles away. They're shut out. The door is closed, whereas in a class action, it's the class action lawyers.
Well, there's some truth to that, but on the other hand, less truth than some of the advocates of that point of view would have it. I think in most MDLs, the court is probably more transparent and what's going on in the case more transparent. There are almost always websites for the MDL. All kinds of stuff is online that wouldn't be online, at least for free, in other kinds of litigation. So anybody who really wants to know what's happening in the MDL has between the plaintiffs, the defendant, and the judge has usually superior ability to be fully informed. What is a little more difficult is that where you have a leadership group in an MDL, the fellow from Missoula with one or two clients is really dependent on the goodwill and the professionalism of the lead lawyers to discuss strategy, tactics, timing, the things that are internal to the plaintiff's group than would be the case in another situation.
And sometimes it's made more complicated than the by the fact that the initiating lawyer from Missoula or wherever has given the case to an aggregator,
yes,
who in turn has been dumped in to your court.
Oh, absolutely.
So it's now two tiers away.
Absolutely true.
Missoula is a lovely city, by the way. It's where the University of Montana is located, not to say anything disparaging about Missoula.
I agree with what Judge Kaplan said, though, about the fact that I think there's so much, there's a lot of transparency nowadays in these MDLs for reasons he stated about court website. Everything I do of any substance goes on our website. When I hold in-court status conferences, we always have a 1-800 number so lawyers from Missoula can call in and listen in without traveling to New Orleans necessarily. They have the ability to file motions independent of the steering committees. If they first require them to seek cooperation or consent of the steering committee, but if they need to attempt to go around them, they have the ability to do that. So there is opportunity, although I understand if a lawyer is in Missoula somewhere in the boondocks and has one or two clients, it's not easy for them to really be involved in the case.
Well, you know, we as the court really don't know what's going on behind the scenes all the time amongst the plaintiffs, but following up on what Elizabeth was saying about communication between class members and lawyers, I would have thought in the era of social media that you're interacting a lot more with all those other lawyers and maybe you're having regular, you know, social media conversations or live conversations or in some way doing a lot more communicating than in the old days. So the phrase shut out may no longer be the case when there's new methods of communication. But you would know, Elizabeth, I mean, do you communicate more than you used to with those many, many, many lawyers? That's what I thought, yeah. No, that was my guess. Say it again.
Yeah, I mean, once conference calls started, 800 numbers, now we have Skype, now we have live social media interactions. It isn't always the most iterative or nuanced. But in terms of just transmitting and receiving information, it's real time.
And the point is it's more than it used to be. The communication among the non-steering committee council, is it more than it was?
It's much more than it was. Sure. And there used to be, the information used to be much more valuable and much more limited. Mm-hmm. Now transcripts of every hearing are instantly available, assuming there's an arrangement to pay the court reporter, but every lawyer and every client has the same time access to them. So the hierarchies that used to exist because of exclusive access to information are broken down.
Are they offering you unsolicited advice from time to time?
I really appreciate all of the advice that I get. and there's plenty of it to choose from.
Yeah.
And the other thing that we do, I'm sure other judges do the same thing, is that when it's not just 15 lawyers on the steering committee that's running the show, because I require them to reach out to other lawyers, plaintiff lawyers I'm talking about now, steering committees, to expand the roles of by subcommittees. I think in our case they call them working groups. It was basically any lawyer that is willing and able to work and contribute common benefit effort should be allowed to do so. And I think at one time we had upwards of 200 lawyers working on plaintiff's side of the case. So they threw together overnight a basically created a large law firm overnight, which has its own problems, of course, of getting along.
Hey, Arthur, can we ask a question about that?
Yeah.
I mean, anybody who's read the fine paper litigation, which is, of course, ancient history, the question would come up, well, you've got 200 lawyers are participating in the common benefit work. That's 200 lawyers generating fees. How do you sort that out, or do you require them to sort it out among themselves?
Well, sort out who does what work?
Who gets paid for what work?
Well, ultimately, I'll decide that. They are required to, first of all, no lawyer can do common benefit work without being authorized to do it. Right. And then secondly, anybody doing common benefit work is required to submit their time and expenses monthly to a CPA that I've appointed. And he tracks it, and then he comes to me once a month with his report, and we look at it, and you know, if I have questions, we go back to the lawyers. And they certainly are just like reviewing any fee bill, except it's more massive, but you're gonna see unnecessary time, you're gonna see, one example, you know, you can look occasionally and you see a lawyer that's has spent all he's doing is reading emails, and it's 15 minutes, I'm sorry, per email. Well, I don't know about you. I don't think I've ever spent 15 minutes reading a single email. But so that kind of thing, that has to be policed for sure. You know?
Well, and you're, of course, doing something that I think it was Judge Kelly didn't do to his great regret, which is monitoring as it's going
along. And then when I get the fee petition or the proposed fee allocation, we're going to look at that again. And I've got a fee committee working on that, but I've interposed between that fee committee and myself a special master who has had totally independent of the other lawyers in the case, and he's going to review the times and expenses, objections, and so forth, and then give me his recommendation. So. That's basically how
it's Steve, I found that the biggest problem is duplicative work. Each lawyer wants to do their own research, even if it's the same research that everybody else did. And so allocating the work so as to avoid the duplication is a really tough job. Again, I'm sure that the steering people have to work on that. Otherwise, you get petitions that are completely duplicative.
Well, you're all describing yourselves, in a way, as managers and administrators. So, as you look back at what's been before you, what stands out as having worked? What works?
I'll tell you one thing that worked for me, and it didn't have anything to do with monitoring lawyers' bills. I think it was the Parmalat MDL, which involved the collapse of that giant Italian company, when somebody went in and found out that the bank account that supposedly had $8 billion in cash actually had none. A little liquidity crisis ensued and the company went down the drain. I had a lot of it was not just a class action, there were individual actions. The Italian bankruptcy trustee, to use the terminology we would use here, had sued on behalf of the bankrupt estate, they sued Bank of America, they sued the accounting firms. There was everything going on in that case. And the thing that truly worked for me in that case was that when I set up the schedule and we looked down the road at the concept of summary judgment motions, I said, I'm not going to have 15 or 20 or 40 or 50 different summary judgment motions, each one with its own assertion of what facts were disputed and what wasn't. So here's the way we're going to do it. Nobody serves a summary judgment motion unless, on a date certain, you send a letter to everybody saying, here's the motion I have in mind, here's the table of contents for my brief, factual, and legal. Everybody look at what's said, and then you all sit down and you negotiate one agreed statement of undisputed facts that will govern in every single case. And if there are legitimate disputes about them, I'll referee them, but you're going to do that first. And when we have this agreed statement across the board as to what facts are undisputed and what you claim are in dispute and what the evidence supporting either side on the disputed points are, then you can move for summary judgment. And putting aside the special issues that related to accountants' liability, there's going to be one brief. And I don't care how many law firms there are, there's going to be one brief. And with the supplements for the individual issues. And we did that, and took a very long time, but it was worth every minute that was spent on it. Ultimately, though it took years, the banks and the accountants got summary judgment. A lot of other people didn't get summary judgment. One big case was tried, the rest settled. But that's what truly worked for me better than anything I've done in any of these cases.
So in all my cases, not just MDLs and class actions, but cases generally, one thing that works pretty well is setting very tight time limits right at the beginning and letting the lawyers know that there are not going to be any extensions. This is going to be held to pretty rigorously. Beyond that, I think it varies with the kind of MDL or kind of class action. For example, in a class action, as the rules themselves suggest, the sooner you can bring it to a certification determination, the better. That will definitely move the case along, subject to, as I said before, the Court of Appeals. But other than that, it really is an important way of moving the case along. In MDLs, several of my MDLs have been toxic tort type MDLs. And there, I found that there's usually a question of general causation before you get to specific causation. And that often involves a Daubert hearing. And so I found it useful to have that hearing sooner rather than later as a way of moving those cases along.
The two most important things, I think, are first, initial conference with the lawyers, the Rule 16 conference, in order to understand what the case is about, to set up the schedule, to have time limits. And second, to listen to the lawyers about what they think are the efficient ways to run the case. Good lawyers can make good suggestions. So, for example, it is possible that there can be a motion for summary judgment on some issues that, in fact, will dispose of the case. I had an MDL which involved patents and antitrust, and the summary judgment motion did dispose of all of the cases. There are other cases in which the lawyers are not quite honest as to whether a preliminary motion, in fact, will dispose of the whole case. Whether if you just take this discovery and do that motion, then everything will be fine. And it won't be fine. All it will do is to delay the case for another year or a year and a half while you go through preliminary discovery and the initial motion. So it requires listening and judgment about what the procedures are for that case. Cases are different.
Yeah.
So
I wanted to answer that too. I think it's a great question to say what works, because it works differently in different cases, but there are some general principles that always work. One is if the judge doesn't let anything slide and decides things promptly. Obviously, nothing kills an MDL worse than not getting a decision. That's obvious. Discovery supervision, and I'm stealing a page from John's book because he was so involved in discovery issues in the rules amendment. We have to figure out how to do proportional discovery, your favorite word, and nowadays phased discovery. I'm convinced that it has to be phased. You just can't do it all at once in a huge MDL. So for example, in my MTBE one, we had to choose just representative wells to do discovery on. You cannot do it on 4,000 wells. We had to identify, let's say, 15 wells for full discovery. Get those wells tried, and then everybody else knew what to do with the rest of the wells. So I know it sounds like bellwethers, but it wasn't really bellwethers as a trial. It was bellwether as discovery. Figure out the facts of 15, and you know the facts of 4,000. So the idea of phasing and very tightly supervising discovery, applying proportionality, are really the keys, I think, to moving things along.
Judge Koeltl is grinning.
Is he? Oh, good. Proportionality, John. Phasing.
No, he, and he knows how much I hate that word.
But, well, so actually, so do I, but, I'm becoming convinced.
Let's all gang up on him.
No, but Professor, Professor Miller doesn't often like to reflect on his important role as reporter for the advisory committee at the time that the 1983 amendments went through, which included proportionality for the first time in Rule 23B2C3. So,
I like the way you can do that from memory.
We tried. We tried to be as faithful to what Professor Miller had done.
You failed miserably.
30 years before. We didn't think that people were adequately listening to what Professor Miller had done.
My fiduciary relationship to this program requires me to move on.
But I could just add, in terms of answering your question about what worked for us, for me, was the first thing I did when I got the case was to stay everything. I'd already been handling about 60 cases before the MDL was created, but we stayed all the individual complaints, stayed all the motions until I set them for hearing, stayed even motions to remand, motions for class certification. And then I spent a couple of months meeting with lawyers, the counsel, after appointing counsel, getting their input and having them meet and confer over a case management order. And what we came up with was, first of all, instead of litigating all these individual complaints, we created pleading bundles for each major category of claims. You know, you had the people, death and personal injury cases from the night of the explosion. We had pure economic claims. We had claims by state governments, federal governments, local governments. We had RICO claims. We had every type of claim you can imagine. And every type of claim had a pleading bundle. And then I ordered the plaintiff steering committee to file a master complaint, one master complaint as to each pleading bundle. Then ordered the defendants to file Rule 12 motions as to each pleading bundle. And that way we were able to resolve a number of very significant legal issues without having chaos in the case. I thought that worked really well. At the same time, part of the case management order that after getting input from a lot of input from the lawyers and back and forth, we came up with a phased trial plan. And I was able to do this probably more easily and more efficiently because this was all an amnesty case, a bench trial. So I phased it into three major trials that I've mentioned before. The first dealing just with the night of the explosion and fire and sinking of the rig, then what happened the next 87 days, and then finally we had a Clean Water Act penalty trial. But in terms of what Judge Scheindlin said, the discovery was largely phase two in response to each trial phase, as each trial phase was coming up. So all right, that all seemed to work well.
Let me turn the coin over. What doesn't work? Why are you smiling, Lou? What?
300-page complaints, they don't work. And the whole business of compensation of counsel in class actions is dramatically broken, in my opinion.
Because
there's really no way to do it. I mean, it's just kind of like going down to Money Tree. The percentage of recovery method, in my view, has only one singular benefit, and that is that judges don't have to think about it. And the lawyers ask for the sun, the moon, and the stars, regardless of how much work was put into the matter. Sometimes it's warranted, sometimes not, but that's true. And the lodestar method all sounds nice in principle, but in a big case, it's effectively unmanageable for the judge. And I think the whole thing is a mess.
What else doesn't work?
It depends what you're talking about in your question. If you're talking about case management, I would come back to what I said before, which is allowing the lawyers to, in effect, take over the scheduling, because any good lawyer will always see 10 other issues that he wanted to address that he forgot to address earlier and will want permission to address them, and discovery that he forgot about that he now sees as important, and the case goes on forever. So it's important for the judge to make clear at all times that the schedule is really a tight schedule that's going to be stuck to. But your question may be a broader one, I don't know. I'm very concerned by the way the Supreme Court of the United States has done a lot to try to kill class actions. Not quite, they're not ready to absolutely kill them, but they're ready to handicap the bringing of class actions. In my view, we all know there are abuses. The class action is one of the few ways in which people with small claims can get access to the courts in a way that a meaningful deterrence of an economic sort can be brought to bear on serious social problems. And from the judicial standpoint, it is greatly increases our efficiency. And I think all those three functions have been disserved by the way in which the trend at the highest court has been against class actions.
Let me add just a couple of things. Jed was really referring to it when he said letting the lawyers run essentially roughshod over the case. I know that there's writing against the judicial management function, and there are judges who take the position that they were appointed to try cases, not to manage cases. On the other hand, if the case isn't managed, it results in higher costs and inefficiencies for the parties. It's like, I remember a college basketball player was not very happy with his coach, and he said all that the coach did in practice was to roll the ball out on the court and say, go practice, which doesn't work very well. It just leads to inefficiencies, more time, et cetera. The other point, which we've touched on before, is lawyers who attempt to deluge the court in an attempt to snow the court. They think that whether it's the 200-page complaint or the request for added pages on a motion for summary judgment, if they simply write enough, even if it's repetitive, the judge won't appreciate what's going on, and for, you know, for sheer dint of being worn down, say, oh, okay, one way or another. That doesn't work. It may result in a longer time to get through the paper, but ultimately it doesn't work.
There were two things I wanted to talk about when you said what doesn't work, and one of them is something you've written about when you've talked about the many stop signs in a case. The 23F, and you alluded to that too, Jed, is a real problem. It just destroys the rhythm of the case. And I did a little statistical analysis again, and in half of my B3 classes, there was a 23F request. And I think that it'd be great if there was this idea of dual jurisdiction, which was done once in the Seventh Circuit, where if you thought it was frivolous and you could really document, you as the district judge, why, you should be able to retain jurisdiction and keep going to get ready for trial, even as the Court of Appeals cogitates for years or months or however long they cogitate. But the idea that we have to stop dead in our tracks in the middle of what we're doing and getting trial ready is really offensive, and there's a lot of 23F action, more in the B3, as I said yesterday, than in the B2. Now, back to your idea of stop signs. Look how many motions we get inundated with. We get the motion to dismiss. We get a Daubert. We get a class cert motion. We get a summary judgment motion. Then we get motions in limine. There are at least 6 or 7 points that the court is inundated with. And, you know, you want to sort of say, I can keep up with them, I can do it, but at best there's us and 2 or 3 helpers, and they are hundreds, and it's really hard to keep up. So if there was some way to keep that rhythm going, not get hung up on the 23F or 1292, we get the certifications can stall things. There's just so much stalling that gets in our way of getting this thing resolved.
You forgot.
Did I?
No, motion to dismiss for lack of jurisdiction.
Well, I said MTDs in general, but I accept the correction. So that makes it six stop signs instead of five, right?
What doesn't work?
Well, I don't know if this falls in the category of what doesn't work, but one of the problems I see in these cases is, and I think Judge Scheindlin just sort of alluded to it, is the lack of resources sometimes that the court has compared to what the parties have. I mean, I was in court one afternoon where we had a courtroom full of lawyers and we were arguing motions, and I got frustrated and said something about the tried to discourage the lawyers from filing a lot of motions, which I thought might be unnecessary. And I pointed out that they had hundreds of lawyers working on each side of this case. And meanwhile, on my side of the case, it was me, one career law clerk, a magistrate judge, and her law clerk, four of us. And I said, just think about that before you file any unnecessary motions, you know? So that's a problem. I don't know what the answer to it is, but maybe the federal judiciary can give MDL judges more resources.
I remember when I was in private practice, Judge Prentice Marshall in Chicago, in a very large antitrust case, looked down at all the lawyers and said, just remember, all of this paper has to pass through the very small eye of a needle, me. Very true.
Look, at the risk of stepping back to a more general point, let me just say a word, raise a question about a particular category of class actions, and I'm speaking of the securities class actions. I haven't looked at the statistics in a number of years, so some of what I will mention may be out of date. But the last time I looked, the recovery in plaintiff securities class action settlements as a percentage of the claimed loss, viewed from the best case perspective of the plaintiffs, was in the range of 2 to 7% of the claimed loss. On average, the attorneys got 25 to 30% of the 2 to 7%, so that the class was recovering something between 1.5 to 5.5% of the best case loss amount had the case gone to trial and had they won. Now, what does that really say? It says that motions to dismiss and summary judgment perhaps are not weeding out an awful lot of very weak cases. Or it says something that might be even more disturbing, which is that the cases are really a lot better than the settlement amounts suggest, but they get settled without going to trial because there's a fee to be made and an uncertainty to be eliminated. Now, or a combination. Whatever it is, the bottom line to me of the system is that this is an enormously expensive way of getting limited compensation to people who may or may not have been victimized, and one would hope there were a better way. I don't know what it is. And for myself, I came to the conclusion, actually to my surprise some years ago, that notwithstanding these data that I've just given you and notwithstanding their implications, I wouldn't throw out securities class actions. I wouldn't. They serve deterrence functions and some limited compensation functions, and they are, all things considered, a whole lot less susceptible to being monkeyed with in consequence of politics, as has happened over and over again with the SEC, and now to go out of this area, the antitrust enforcement efforts in the federal government. We just don't have a situation where a new administration comes in with a particular ideological bent and they can wipe out the plaintiff's securities class action bar. It's not going to happen. But maybe all of this is born in some memory on the fact that when I started practicing law in 1970, I was an antitrust lawyer for 10 years. And then Ronald Reagan got elected, and then there were no more openings for antitrust lawyers anywhere. It was gone, antitrust enforcement.
Follow up on what Lou said, I don't know off the top of my head what a better system is. If you think that the recovery is 2%, 3%, the recoveries that I've seen are higher in my cases when we look at fee amounts and what the representations are as to what the percentage of recovery is. But in any event, if it's 2, 3, whatever percent, it's not a kind of a case where you think that a motion to dismiss should be granted because the plaintiffs have some chance of eventually succeeding, and it's not for the judge to say, well, I don't think you're eventually going to succeed at trial. I'm going to throw your case out and give you nothing. So the case proceeds. It may go to summary judgment, and the same factors are at stake. And then the lawyer is faced with the prospect of, do I risk it all by going to trial or not? So judge is really not in a position to say, yeah, you've got to go to trial. You may lose, but you've got to go to trial. The class will get nothing, you'll get nothing, but you ought to go to trial.
I should have been clear that there are, of course, exceptions to these very low numbers, but these very low numbers are an across-the-board average. And some of the exceptions are fantastic, and there we are.
So, I mean, there are three different... So there are three.
Did you take that into account in your calculations?
You know, I can't actually. That's not my source, by the way, and I can't speak for what the source of the damage exposure that was used by the study that I read was. I just can't tell you. Just don't know.
All right. Because I know that when I file a case, I'm ample in what I would claim are the damages I'm going to prove, and it's going to be an exaggeration.
Yes.
Yeah. So let okay. me okay. let me okay. give you the benefit of the doubt and say
we've just heard a Rule 11 violation.
There you go,
Jed. You were about to talk.
So there are three purposes to class action. So in their origins, if you go back to Equity Rule 48, which was the original source of Rule 23, it was a mere matter of judicial efficiency, and that's still important. Then the rationale became, and still is to a substantial extent, compensation of victims. That plays, it's a more complicated matter in securities cases than others, because in some ways you have present shareholders paying present or past shareholders, so it's not so clear how the compensation plays out in many of those cases. But I do think that there has been, since the statistics that Lou mentioned, I think compensation percentage-wise has gone up, and it's primarily because attorneys' fees have been cut down in cases where the compensation percentage is as low as in those figures you just gave. But the third purpose I really want to reemphasize is deterrence. Unfortunately, the government doesn't either have the resources or perhaps the will in many cases to act as a deterrent. Let me give you some examples. In the famous Enron case, a huge accounting fraud, the SEC settled its case against Enron for $450 million. The class action was settled for $7.2 billion, 16 times the SEC settlement. In Tyco, another huge fraud, the SEC settled its case for $50 million, the parallel class action was settled for $3.2 billion, 64 times what the SEC settled for. In a case before me involving Bank of America, the financial crisis, the SEC was originally going to settle that case, which involved allegations of defrauding the company, defrauding its own shareholders, to the tune of billions, was going to settle it for $50 million. I disapproved it. They ultimately convinced me to accept the settlement for $150 million. The parallel class action, based on exactly the same facts, was settled for $2.4 billion. It's only these class actions that are having meaningful, in the absence of criminal cases, having meaningful deterrent effect in these cases. The SEC settlements are paltry and cannot seriously be said to achieve deterrence of what the SEC itself is saying is substantial fraud in this case.
So now, to harmonize what Lou was saying, what Jed was saying, you have deterrence versus compensation as two values, which we heard in the last panel. You may be having that deterrence, but when you talk about compensation and you get that notice, not you because you're the lawyer, but when I get those notices in the mail and realize for my two or three shares I'm going to have to do hours of work to find some certificate, it isn't worth it. It goes in the basket. So what's the real compensation to the real shareholders? You know, it's pennies often. With the PSLRA, I actually know what it is per share. It's not much. So the compensation notion and the deterrence notion may be two different things.
But in some cases, I suspect your case, compensation is a much more significant factor in the minds of the
not a securities
members.
Case, though. You're talking
not
about
a securities
right,
case.
That we, right, we were
no,
talking
it's
for
difference
a moment.
In different contexts.
Exactly, exactly. But Lou was talking about securities fraud cases, and
yeah.
I understand.
Yeah.
Let me.
Oh, if you want to go there, you have a question.
Yeah. In terms of the percentage of recovery, I think one thing has to be kept in mind. I would have class members come to me and they would say, I purchased my stock for $4 a share and now it's down to $2 a share, so my loss is $2, why don't I get my $2 back? But what the class member doesn't realize is that at the same time that their shares went down from 4 to 2, the market in general may have gone down by 10%. And there may have been other factors so that they're not focusing on how much they lost because of the fraud, which is all that the court is going to compensate them for. And so while it may be that it seems like they're only getting a small percentage of the drop in the stock price, they may in fact be getting a far greater percentage of the loss that was due to the fraud that the case was supposed to remedy.
And the very process of figuring that out is an expensive and time-consuming process, complexifying what is already a complex case.
And not an exact science either.
Yeah. Judge Higginbotham of the Fifth Circuit, a personal favorite of mine, he has expressed a concern that the federal judiciary is now indistinguishable from a regulatory agency. I'd like your reactions to that. I'd like you to think about when you went into this profession or became a judge, did you think that you'd be worried about tag-along cases, Lou, or calibrating attorneys' fees? And fess up, do you resent it?
I'll answer the first one. I didn't really think about any of those things. I started law school the year Rule 23 was amended, 1966, and who the hell knew what was going to come out of that? I mean, certainly not I. And by the time I went on the bench, of course, we'd come 24 years down the road, and I imagined there would be a fair amount of it. I mean, do I resent it? Not the right word.
Just part of the job description.
It is. Absolutely it is. Yeah.
Some of your colleagues on various benches around the country do seem to resent it,
well,
particularly
look,
those who believe that the gold standard always was trial before a jury.
Sure, and I can perfectly well understand that. But life has moved on. I mean, this is where we are. People leave the bench when they feel they're not getting paid enough. People leave the bench when they don't like the work anymore. And if that's where their heads are, well, it's a course open to them. I'm still having a ball.
It It's the mindset that I referred to before. Those who criticize managerial judging. Did I expect it? Yes. I mean, I was in private practice. I worked on large cases when I was in private practice. I understood what judges did. When I went through my confirmation hearing, one of the questions I got was, the senator said to me, there's a lot of concern out there with respect to backlogs in the federal judiciary. What will you do to move your cases along? And I won't repeat what some of my friends told me the answer to that question should have been, but in any event, it was out there. So I expected it. Do I resent it? No, not at all. First of all, there is a joy to taking a case and seeing that it is moved along to the point where it is settled or tried. Judge Scheindlin mentioned some of those things before. That's not inconsistent at all with the desire to try the case. Judges much prefer trying the case rather than deciding a motion for summary judgment. The purpose of managing the case is to get it to the point where it either is settled or tried. I mean, there is a perception out there among some that judges try to are a factor in trying to discourage cases going to trial. I don't believe that's true. I mean, we enjoy trying cases. It's part of why we became judges. So
even though I prefer cases that go to trial more often than these kind of cases do, I don't think I resent this at all. First of all, these cases are challenging. Secondly, they often evolve from important social issues. And thirdly, most importantly, they get you invited to nice conferences at NYU. So.
Well, I too did not resent it at all. I didn't feel like a regulatory agency. The judicial branch is there so that people can bring their problems to the court. I didn't create investigations. I didn't do the investigation. I got served up with a case, and then my job was to do the best I could to get that case to a close. And that's a fair function. I don't look at it as what a regulatory agency does. I look at it as doing justice, and that was, of course, the best thing that a trial judge can do. And one of the things I've often said about being a trial judge that I really love the most is the trial judge shapes the record. I gave that talk recently. Elizabeth heard it. But we shape the record, and it's that record that goes up the line. The people above us don't get to shape the record. They can only respond to what we've done. And so it's a very, very special role.
In theory.
No, well, yeah. When they go outside the record, I resent, to use your word, that I resent when they reach outside the record. But I love the fact that we can do that shaping. So I don't resent it at all.
Yeah. No, I don't. I have no resentment either. But I do say I think I'm of the same vintage as Judge Kaplan here, because I got out of law school in 1970, clerked for state court, appellate court, and then for federal district judge. And even though the Rule 23 was in existence, I don't think we knew it was in existence in 1970, because I don't recall seeing a single class action at that time. And the caseload was very different. Fast forwarding more, obviously by the time I got to the court 18 years ago, I was very aware of what was going on in federal courts, and because a substantial part of my practice was always in federal court. But we were having a conversation with Judge Scheindlin the other night about trials, about the lack of trials, and of course this has been a downward trend for years. And it's not just in federal system. My friends in state courts are seeing the same thing. And I think it's attributable to, you know, the prevalence of ADR. Our magistrate judges spend half of their time settling cases. That's what they do. And, of course, arbitration.
Also the cost of going to trial.
Right,
enormous.
Exactly,
right.
The cost of discovery and trials.
Right.
But just, I looked the other day, and as recently as like 5 or 6 years ago, I had 25 trials in 1 year. This year, I think I've had four. And in recent years, it's 4 or 5 compared to 25 just a few years ago. And so we have become more managers than trial judges. And it's not, I mean, I'm not pleased with that, but I don't think I resent it. It's just the way it is, as Judge Kaplan said, you know.
So you're somewhere between indifference and resentment.
Not happy, Paul.
Not happy. Does that equate to unhappy?
You want somebody to say resent.
No. I do. No. Look,
I'm not unhappy. I'm just.
There's an audience. Mike.
Well,
do you want it?
You know, I don't know whether to do a mea culpa or not do a mea culpa. When I became the reporter and the committee decided it was going to focus on the pretrial process, discovery, which is the birth of proportionality, Rule 11, and management. And I guess I'm the reporter that took many of the ideas from the then nascent Manual on Complex Litigation and brought them into Rule 16. And I remember when I, as the reporter, would go out to judicial conferences and talk to you folks about the implications of the new rule, the kickback I would get about this diversion of judicial energy from adjudication to management is very different from what the five of you just expressed. It's a generational difference, I suppose.
You did a great job, Arthur. I mean, you did. I mean,
I have that... my doubts, John.
Well, but when you put the question, do we resent? You're assuming that judges have emotions, which is an open question.
That's another line I won't touch. Yeah.
Do you want a question?
Oh, yes, on the issue of whether courts have become regulatory agencies, I'm wondering if it isn't the opposite problem. Judge Rakoff's recent article in the New York Review of Books on five reasons why you won't get your day in court mentioned Chevron deference, and I wonder if the problem isn't really that the regulatory agencies have assumed a lot of the lawmaking or functions of the Article III courts.
You mean adjudicatory functions too?
Adjudicatory, yes.
SEC, right? Immigration judges, SEC, sure.
But just
reactions?
Well, look, sure, you know, you must know about all the cases, because I assume it's why you asked the question, in which the SEC has been attacked for suddenly swinging to heavy use of administrative proceedings away from injunction suits in the district courts. Now, very interesting issue, good arguments on both sides as a matter of policy. I threw one of those cases out for lack of jurisdiction because there's review of the SEC by the Court of Appeals. There was the Tilton case that did pretty much the same thing, both affirmed in the Second Circuit. Someday the Supreme Court will probably hear it. My policy views about what's desirable and what I felt compelled to do are two entirely different things.
Right. Yeah. I guess I didn't use the mic enough. Is that what you were saying? So I had also pointed out the adjudicatory function, SEC, immigration, Social Security, so many adjudicatory agencies outside of the court that sometimes divest us, as happened with immigration.
So, I mean, this is a broader problem, really beyond the scope of this conference in some ways, but I'm flattered that you read my article. But
we all read your article.
But anyway, the point of it is that the access of Americans to their normal courts has tremendously declined for a whole host of reasons, but that's certainly one of the reasons.
All right, we've got just a couple minutes left. I think this is still a Rule 23 conference, so I will ask each of the panelists, if you could change one thing about Rule 23, what would you change? What would you change? And rescission is an option.
23F.
23F, interlocutory appeals.
Yes.
23F.
Thank you.
I'll go along with that, though. I'm hard pressed to think of a case where I had a 23F on a class they served.
I had 8 out of 14 on the security side. I tracked them. And of those 5 were granted, 3 they didn't take. Of the 5 they took, I have the statistics. So I think they're actually in securities cases, they ask for it at least half the time.
Well, I agree with that. But for the sake of saying something slightly off topic and different, I'd overrule lexicon.
You'd true. Overrule.
Me too. Yeah.
Good
me too.
For you.
Good for you.
Good, good suggestion.
You know, I don't really have a problem with 23F, but it hadn't been a problem for me, despite the fact that I've had 90 different appeals in the Deepwater Horizon case. But it didn't slow us down. We just kept going. So that didn't become a problem. But the lexicon issue is a big issue. Yeah. I agree with Judge Kaplan. Fortunately, I was able to overcome that because Judge Keith Ellison in Houston was wise enough to transfer the case directly to me before it came as a tag-along. And so we solved that problem that way. But otherwise, it would have caused some big problems in my case if I couldn't try that limitation action.
But legislative proposals to turn it over have gone nowhere.
Why?
I don't know why.
I would hazard a guess
home court,
that it has
home court advantage.
Slight variation on that. I think that lawyers in cases that get into MDLs who are not happy about being there want to preserve the option from getting the case back for trial if it ever happens in their home court, and then get the contingency fee if they win.
Sure. Trial, sure. It's a little bit different than losing it for pretrial purposes.
We just said home court advantage. You want to try your case before your judge. Who knows you?
Isn't it time to start from ground zero? I mean, if you start, I don't want an answer to this, good. Or if you want to give me an answer, give me an answer. We've got 23. We know that part of the function of major, complex, multi-district cases has been taken over by 1407. Now we've got the emergence of the so-called quasi class from Judge Hellerstein and Judge Weinstein. It's like a crazy quilt. So maybe next year we should have another conference on eradication and resurrection.
On that note,
my thanks to the panel.
Thank you, Arthur.